welcome to Radiorama. This is where we show you how to fix up old electronics. We work on radios and other electronics from the 20s through the 60s. So today we're going to work on an airline console from probably the late 50s, early 60s. And we'll show you how to clean it up, how to make it work, and enjoy it.
Thank you, Steve. And if you don't know, Steve is the president of our museum, whose name I can't mention. And we are working on, as he said, probably in 1950s, maybe even early 60s, Montgomery Ward's. It is a model number, it says article number. That number is too long for me to read. Oh, model number WG2858A. As far as Montgomery Ward's goes, if you're not from the U.S., they were a large department store brand, and they existed all the way up to, I think, the late 90s, early 2000. And just like all of the other department store brands, they contracted out with other manufacturers to make their stuff. And while I'm not a super specialist about this, I believe that this was probably made by Wells Gardner. Wells Gardner, which I think might still be around. I think they make gaming consoles or something for the gambling industry. But the reason I think it's a Wells Gardner is because they had this tendency to put all of their, like, instead of having a separate amp chassis, they would put the amp and the tuner chassis all in one big chassis. And here it is. And what little I've had a chance to look at, it looks like we have a single-ended output, two 6BQ5s, and we have a set of two very generic 12-inch speakers, set of horn tweeters, a record player, audio inputs over here for multiplex and tape player. And it definitely smells like high heavens, like cigarettes. You can see all the nicotine smoke and everything on it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring a variac out here with a cord just to see and diagnose what the situation is with it. We have a voice of music record changer that seems to be pretty loose. I do not feel a needle here because the needle is gone. That's too bad. Anyway, we'll get a variac out here and give it a chest run. All right, so we have our variac out here. And I've got, it looks like the way you turn it on is via these little buttons. That's off. It's kind of sticky. Okay, we got it on FM. Supposedly it's on. Let's bring it up about just 50% initially. That's not going to do anything. We got a little pilot light here. It looks like that's burned out. So that's not doing anything. All right, let me look in the back here, see if there's any kind of filament. Even though at 50%, probably won't see much of anything. Nope, I don't see anything. Let's just bring it up a little bit more. I'm not sure if this has any pilot lights behind the dog glass here, or maybe they're burned out. I don't know. All right, let's take a look in the back here. Aha! We got filament. These buttons are really sticky. Boy, oh boy. Here we are. Okay, the answer is that I think it might work, but we've got a lot of filthy dust bunnies going on here. Well, let's see if any of these tubes are wiggly. Try that. All right, screw it. It's not going to work until we take this out and clean some of the gunk that's gunking up these switches, but I don't hear any humming. So I think that probably this is going to need a cleaning and a recap job, but what we're going to have to do is pull this entire thing out of there. And I looked already in the back, and this whole thing is going to come straight out of the top like that. But first we need to remove all the cableage and all the other shit that's holding that in there. And then we'll take it into the shop, take a look under the hood. All right, so we're removing the chassis. There's my assistant today, Brett, and he is going to be helping do some of the cosmetic stuff. And he also has a friend who works on record players. So he took out the changer, and later we'll take a look and see if the idle wheel on it is okay, because otherwise we might need to order a manufactured unit from the Voice of Music out of Michigan. And what I'm also doing is I'm marking all of the cables here so that I'm not confused when I put it back together again. Now Brett is going to start working on the case here. He's using a product called Howard's Restore Finish. That'll help even out and like kind of reflow some of this old finish. Likewise, we're going to clean this. This is not supposed to be nicotine yellow. It's supposed to be silver. It's just that whoever owned this thing smoked like a chimney and discolored it. So we'll use Simple Green on that, which is a mild cleaner. If you don't have Simple Green in your country, it's fine. You can use something else. Just don't make sure it's not too harsh. To get this chassis out, there's two bolts. One here, one there. If I pull those, then it should just pull out this way and out. And I should be able to get the whole thing in one big chunk. I'm going to continue labeling these wires before I do that, because again, it's not super obvious on these things how you hook it up. It's all a bunch of spade connectors, and I'd rather not lose my place. All right, well, we got half the museum involved now. So Brett is going around cleaning up the cabinet, which is already looking a lot better. Raj helped me remove the chassis, and I was looking here, and in addition to the 6BQ5s, or if you're on the other side of the pond, EL84, we have a set of 7025s, which I looked up. They're basically the same thing as 12AX7. I could be wrong, so some YouTube geniuses can correct me. But now that this is out of the case, I'm going to bring it into the shop, and we have a bunch of electrolytics that need to be replaced. We have these two cans. And it looks like there's juice that has leaked out of this one. And let's see what it looks like underneath to see if it looks like anything is spewing. Oh yeah, look at that. I can't believe this thing fucking worked. See that? All the juice is coming out of that electrolytic. That is ruptured. Ruptured in a very bad way. And we were lucky that something catastrophic didn't happen when we fired it up. And you see this too, this electrolytic, that's probably a bias cap that's going to one of the output tubes, 100 microfarads, and see this red rupture? That's ruptured as well. And we got a whole bunch of bumblebee caps. They're just paper caps and housed in Bakelite, and they will explode if they get moisture leaks. Anyway, looks like the transformer's okay. It's a good thing that we didn't leave this on very long. That could have been a lot of damage. Stupid me. Okay, so I've got the chassis up here. I took all the tubes out because they were covered in nicotine stains. So now they're cleaned up here, and then Brett is going to test them on our Hickok tube tester. Now I'm going to start replacing electrolytic capacitors. Our values are marked on the side here. We have an 80, 60, 220s. And here's our replacements. So we have an 80 microfarad here. So I'm going to tie two 47s together, and that will give me close enough value for that one. Same with the 60 microfarad, and then we have this single 60 microfarad cap here. So we'll flip it over and replace one at a time. Okay, so now we have all the electrolytics replaced. I had to double some of these up because I don't have the right values. There were two 80s and two, well, there was one 80 microfarad and a 60 microfarad. So I had to double up my 47s to get closer to that value. You can go over, it doesn't have to be exact. Meanwhile, what I'm doing is replacing all these bumblebees. And I never did remember or memorize how to read resistors, but you read them the same way. So you got two reds, it's 22,000, which equals 0.02, well, 22,000 picofarads. Replace those with 0.02 microfarad caps. It's the same thing. Not a whole lot left. And then, of course, we'll need to clean the controls here, including this jerry-rigged piece of crap here. And then reinstall the tubes, rush it back outside, plug it in, see if it works better than it did. All right, so Brett went over this with Howard's. Looking a whole lot better. I'm real surprised. So meanwhile, I've just about finished recapping the chassis, and probably will bring this set inside because it's been lightened, and then we'll reinstall and see what it sounds like. But let's go back to the chassis. There's a few more things I need to do before we do that. All right, so all the caps are replaced on this guy, and now what I'm going to do is clean the pots. And what you do is you get a little contact cleaner, and you see these little slots here. I'm going to go in and spray all that. I'm probably using way too much because I'm doing this one-handed with a camera. And just work it back and forth. You can see the wipers already. You're just smearing the new cleaner all over the surfaces of the pots. And don't be afraid to hit it up several times if it's especially gunky like this one is. Also need to clean all these push buttons. And how you do that is you just like literally soak all of that liberally. Contact cleaner. Then work your buttons back and forth. That's already working a lot better. Probably hit that a few more times. Then we'll haul this thing out to the cabinet, and we'll see if it wakes. Okay, so my friend Rajesh is helping me do some diagnostics, and we think that it's a ground issue between the volume pot and the balance control. Because what Rajesh did earlier is we were able to short a section of the balance control, and that confirmed that we have a grounding issue. We're just trying to figure out what that is. It could be a bad solder joint. Could be a broken wire. We're not totally sure, but hopefully we'll find out. Okay, so an update. We think maybe there's an issue with the balance pot, as in a physical issue. You see how this wiggles up and down. There's a lot of play in that, which could be affecting the wipers and their contact with the material. So what we're thinking is, we can't get the volume pot to work. Either replace it, I'm not sure what the value is because we don't have a schematic, or just do without balance. When's the last time that you actually adjusted the balance control on a stereo? But whatever, we'll figure it out. Okay, so Rajesh was kind enough to solve the problem here. Here's this little diagram here. What'd you do, Rajesh?
Well, it's actually the ground was missing here. That's the problem. The ground for the pot is, you know, coming through the shield wire all the way from the balance pot. That was broken, so that was the issue. So we had to reattach that thing, clean it, and rewire it.
Anyway, Rajesh, as usual, used his genius to help us out on this one, so now it's working very well. So what I'm going to do now is put it the bottom back on it, and we're going to test fire it in the cabinet because it's probably going to sound a lot better instead of using these dinky little speakers. To keep myself occupied, I've been working on this shitty little General Electric, so I'm kind of annoyed by it right now. So perfect time to take a break, put it back in the cabinet. Okay, so we are busy installing the chassis. I find it's a lot easier if you have a weird situation like this where the chassis goes up from the bottom. If you just put the console on its side, and that way you don't have to fight gravity. You can just put it in here and like whoosh, slide it forward. Unfortunately, we broke one of the leads for one side of the speaker. We got to fix that. Then we'll tip it right side up and give it a test. Okay, well, we finally have come to the end of this console's journey. It was truly a team effort. I want to thank Rajesh, Brett. Brett, I don't remember your friend's name, but Brett has a friend who works on record players. And then Steve, who did the intro. And then I worked on some of it as well, doing the recap job. And it turned out real nice. I've got my Bluetooth running through the audio input section. Likewise, the record player is working great here. I'm terrible at working on record changers, but this works perfectly now. And so let's give this a try. And it's basically queuing up. And here goes the music. Anyway, it turned out really great. Everything works on it really well. The finish on it turned out well. And so as always, if you liked what you saw in this episode, make sure and press that like button. And comments are always welcome. And until the next time, obsolete electronics goes across my bench. I'll see you next time.